Hi everybody, this is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we thought we'd talk about basic handy garden tools. Many people have asked us, well, what do you use in your garden? And we thought, well, we'll start from the very, very beginning. That would be sticks. I think the earliest gardeners probably use sticks to dig, to plant their seeds, to hold up their crops. Very basic. I don't think you can get too much more basic than that than using your own two hands.
So is that where sticks and stones came from?
It might have. Then Rick remembers as a kid using kitchen utensils that his mom either didn't know he had.
My grandma.
Or your grandma. Or that they said was okay. And an old tin can to scoop with. Another just very basic way to start. I have found, and thank goodness, I have my garden knife shovel with the serrated edge, the notch cutting edge, the measuring
depth
for planting, and also just for scooping. This is probably the tool I use the most, except for my gloves. I enjoy wearing gloves, and there are different gloves for different purposes. If you're going to be working with prickers or woody things that need more protection, you might want a pair of leather gloves. If you're going to be planting, you might want to use the ones that have the neoprene that will give you protection for the soil but still have breathing areas.
Also water too, right?
Well, the water would be on the inside, obviously.
Right.
This would just be more for the breathing of your hands.
But I mean, if you're working with water or a water plant or something.
True, yes.
Or even a wet garden.
Yes. Okay, many men like the leather gloves. This is very good for taking out prickers, doing heavier work.
Well, and it prevents blisters.
Yes, true. And then if you're going to be doing something like roses or very large prickers to be covered higher up on your arms would be a great idea.
I have some huge welding gloves that
they
I use
have
too.
Come very handy with some of those very large thistles that seem to pop up in our yard all the time. But then you have your clipping tools. You have your clippers that have a ratchet in them. These work very well if you're doing pruning small branches. And if you need something that's even smaller, to use these little clippers that have a very smaller range with them, but are very sharp and very good for doing actual plant trimming.
Well, especially topiaries, I found
yes.
that be handy. Now, are those
and flowers.
The ones Graham sent us?
Yes, they are.
Those are really quality tools.
Very, very nice. They're heavy and they're
heavy duty,
they're
sturdy.
Great. This was a tool that came in very handy when we were doing our topiaries because they're the professional kind of trimmer that they use in gardens where they have a lot of topiaries. Perfect for doing evergreens. Very, very good. Then you're going to get into trimming in, or digging in the ground. Rather than using a stick, you can use something that has little claws. Again, this is like the fork, only it's sturdier, obviously. This one has a little, like a hatchet attachment to it.
Looks like the bent forks I used to play with as a kid.
Yep. And then, although this is, should probably be down with the other cutting tools, this is a very handy folding knife, so it fits well into your bag that you're going to carry tools in if you do that. But it's very good for cutting limbs off of trees. Another very basic tool is your shovel. If you're from a farm, if you've ever worked on a farm, you know this tool. This is for cleaning out barns and
stalls,
and we found it very helpful for moving mulch, especially off of driveways.
Yep.
Your basic shovels, one with the longer handle. I really like this one because it not only is a shorter handle, but it also has a grip on it so it doesn't twist in your hand while you're trying to use it. Our grandson often likes to help in the garden, so we obliged him by picking up a shovel for him.
So in other words, you have papa shovel, mama shovel, and baby shovel.
There you go. It's never too early to start shoveling.
Which one is just perfect?
Depends on the job you're doing.
So those are spade shovels.
Yes.
Okay.
And then we have this kind of shovel, which would be, I think, for digging deeper but more narrow.
Now they call it a drainage spade.
Yes. And then here's one of our favorites that we just found about a couple years ago when the Root Assassin people sent us this handy tool that is excellent for digging out buckthorn. And our friends the Millers in Ohio just emailed today and said they just got theirs.
Well, they ordered one
today. They ordered one today. Well, they saw ours and they had seen what we did with it and they were very impressed with it and have ordered their own.
Well, I've got to tell you, when we first used this, remember we had a dead apple tree?
Yes.
And we had planted a bunch of flowers around it?
Yes.
So we carefully brought the Root Assassin in. We actually cut the roots of that apple tree without disturbing any of the flowers.
Yep, the petunias continued to grow for
that
the rest of
that was incredible.
Summer. This is a handy tool. This is made. This is sold by the Root Assassin people in the United States here. So
yeah. All you have to do is
comes with a guard.
You start it up there at the top, and you simply slide it down.
Oh, okay. There you go. And it's good to keep that on there. It's sharp.
Well, you can actually file those and make them even sharper, too.
You don't want them to
or have them professionally bound.
Bumping into other ones. This is a tool that we got just this summer. This is an edging tool. Very handy for doing edges along walkways or to separate your garden area from your lawn area. Comes with these nice firm grips on it, and it gives you more control, and it's easier on your hands, obviously.
Well, it's either that or use a shovel like this, which is kind of a square spade.
This is what we used before that.
Yeah.
Has a very square bottom to it, as opposed to the rounded, more rounded edge on there.
Which cuts in actually better. I like that rounded surface because
it gives you that ability to rock it back and forth and get down farther.
Where this you're trying to cut everything at once, that's really cutting from the middle and then sliding up both sides. So that worked very well.
This served us well, though, all the while that we used it. This one, I think you picked up at a rummage sale, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I think it was maybe $1 or $2 for this little sod scraper.
This is an old tool, a very old tool. But it gets, if you're trying to remove sod, it gets right under the surface.
Or plants or anything.
Yep.
I mean, you can really get
and
down underneath.
And it slices under.
Yeah.
Again, rummage sale. This is a great time to be looking for them. This time of year, you're probably thinking of adding bulbs to your yard. This would be a great tool. It's hollow. It's like a circular shovel. You can step down on it with your foot to get into the soil with a better control, but it has a nice grip on the top so that you can use not only your foot to guide, but you can control it with your hands on the top.
Plus you have the depth too, so depending on how far deep you need to go, you know that that's almost a 12-inch depth right there. I thought that one might have had a guide on the side, but I don't see it anymore.
No.
I know some of them do where they'll tell you whether it's 1 inch, 2 inches, 4 inches, 6 inches,
because
whatever.
Because different bulbs have to be planted at different depths.
And what's the rule of thumb for planting a bulb?
It's about 3 to 4 times what the height of the bulb is. So if you are planting a tulip bulb, which is this deep, then you have to add like 3 or 4 times how deep that is. So tulip bulbs can be almost a foot into the ground, depending on how big they are. Where crocuses, which are much smaller, would only have to be that deep into the ground.
Well, we lost, I think, almost all of ours, mainly because we had so much mulch.
Right. And they only last for so many years. So, you know, bulbs don't last a lifetime. You add to them and you divide them and you share them.
Well, I should also mention that this is also a perfect time of year to fertilize your lawn, but it's also when we put out a sign on our lawn asking our neighbors for their bagged leaves and grass clippings.
Yes.
No scrap, garden scraps,
no,
but
you don't want
bagged leaves and grass cutting, because that works beautifully. In fact, that's how all of our berms were built.
Right. And many people are trying to find a place to
dump
where
them.
Do I go with all of these leaves I collected? And if they don't have gardens to put them in, we will happily take their leaves.
Yeah.
Then you have tools that chop bigger things.
Loppers.
This is a hedge
clippers,
trimmer,
yeah.
Right? With extending arms, so you can reach down in to, or in farther in or up into a higher tree.
Or bush.
And then you have loppers. Loppers are some of my favorite tools. This is a ratcheting lopper, so that it opens up that wide, and then as you squeeze it closed,
it clicks.
It'll click and ratchet into a different gear ratio so that you can actually get through thicker branches than you would actually be able to. That too has extending arms that pull out, allows you to have either more strength or better
leverage.
Uh-huh. Right. And then this was one from the Dram Corporation, which is extremely sharp, has worked very well for us. That too has arms that extend or close up depending on what your need is for that time. So when you're trimming, sometimes trees need to have their branches cut. This is a handsaw for trimming tree limbs.
And again, you can have those sharpened or get a new blade.
Right, and there are different sizes of them.
Yep.
So depending on the size of tree that you want to take control of yourself. Sometimes your tree limbs that need to be taken down are very high up in the tree. You don't want to use a ladder. They're not that high, but they're beyond your reach. That's when you use something like this, a pole trimmer, where you can extend it up high up into the tree, and then from the ground you can pull, and the actual blade does the work as you pull on it.
I can't tell you how many times I've used this.
And then you have to yell four, because they fall down on people that are trying to help you. When you're in your garden, there are times when you need to till up the soil. You don't really need to do a lot, perhaps, but you need very specific areas to do that. And then that's when you might use a hoe.
Is that what you use in wintertime to do our driveway with a hoe?
No.
Oh.
No, I don't.
Okay.
Shovel. That's when I use a snow shovel.
Okay.
And then you might have a need to do something that's more aggressive than a hoe to start with, and that would be this claw, like a claw hoe or a claw rake. Very, very handy tool.
And when they break, then you can modify these
yep,
to become a little hand rake.
Cut them down like
sure.
this and put a hole in, and then use it as a hand chopper. It's a little taller than the one we showed you earlier, but very, very strong, so it would give you nice leverage.
And when you do have tools, because of this type of a collet that wraps around the actual wood pole or plexiglass pole, they do have replacement poles you can buy.
Yes.
But we have found some of them, the handle itself is more expensive than buying a whole new tool.
That's right. Unfortunately, so, that's how it turns
but
out.
But rummage sales are still a great place to find tools,
rummage
especially this time of year.
Garage sales, right. Garage sales are fantastic. Sometimes even Goodwill or Salvation Army or St. Vincent de Paul will have tools that people have brought in, and there's nothing wrong with them. They are just, if they are rusty, you can use steel wool and clean them up, sharpen them a little bit. They're perfect.
And being that this is fall, this is a great time to go to your favorite store, a garden center or hardware store, because they're trying to empty their shelves of the summer tools. So you can often find tools at a great bargain. In fact, remember that foot shovel that we showed?
The edger?
That one we found on sale for almost half the price.
Yep.
The price.
They're trying to clear away the last year's
inventory.
Yeah. Christmas is coming. They want to get all their decorations and things out. So this is a great time.
Now, how many times have you estimate that you've used this tool?
Well, considering all the mulch we throw around here.
How many tons?
Don't even know how many to start with. This is a very good one. This is probably more for hay and straw in one that was first created. It works great for leaves.
Well, they have them even wider than this, because
yes.
When we were on the Amish farms, we saw one that had like 10 tines to
right.
it.
Right, yep.
Rather than just
but
five tines.
This is so nice, and I like this handle again because it gives me more control. It gives me something
and
bigger
leverage.
To hold
yeah.
on to. Then you have your the one that's more for use in soil. This would be for digging potatoes or getting out really stubborn weeds. Again, nice handle on it. Look for good handles. Then there are times when you need rakes, and maybe not a big rake. Maybe you're not doing leaves in your garden yet or in your yard, but you need something for your garden. This is one of my favorite ones. It's small enough that I can do a little area, but it's very controllable and very handy. And then there's this one that adjusts so that if you need something wider, it spreads out so that you can do lots of leaves and bigger things, bigger areas. But if you need something that's very small, it can be adjusted just for that.
Now, I will say this. The thing that I do not like about this particular rake is that no matter what size you have it set at, it tends to twist.
It does. It tends to twist and it tends to
change.
Let go and
yeah.
and kind of expand itself either out or in.
So I don't know if the manufacturer will create something a little stronger as a clamp that would keep it in position, but
right.
that's what I would recommend to whoever makes this type of
right.
a rake.
Or somewhere you can adjust it so it, as it loosens up, it doesn't loosen so far you can't keep it where it belongs.
Right. And of course, if you live where there are a lot of trees,
well, if
bushes.
There's a lot of trees and bushes, and fall is coming. This one, I believe when we first got it, had a scoop that you
it
could
does. We've got the
up.
Scoop, actually. It looks like a double rake.
Yes.
Because it has a cover to it.
Right. And here again, you can,
and you can
do
adjust it
more deeply or
shallow.
Shallow, right.
Yeah. But the other part of the rake looks almost exactly like this, except you use it with, it's
right.
a handheld.
Right. So that you can
scoop them
up
together.
Lots of leaves and then dump them where you want them.
Yeah.
Then, of course, there are the mechanical tools that you might want for your garden. They're not necessary, but they sure make life easier. This, of course, is a gas-powered
trimmer
that has the nylon cord that comes out and spins around and chops off all the tall grasses around rocks and fences and
weeds,
things that you don't want in your garden. Or you just want them trimmed and neat. You just want to be careful when you're doing around your trees because these also whip up along the bark of your trees and are harmful. Then there's gardening. You need to have something at times that will till the garden. This little baby has served us very, very well for many, many years. This is a Mantis tiller. It's light enough that I can use it, but it's very efficient and it works great in our raised beds.
Well, that's a small bed, so you're not going to be pulling up a huge rototiller just to get into that
right.
type of a garden.
Well, it'd be hard to get it into the bed and then all the soil would be tilled right out. So. Great one. Now when you have a driveway or a sidewalk or a curb that you have soil right up next to or your grass, probably your grass, in order to make it look really neat and clean, you want some kind of edger. And that's where this little tool comes in handy. This would rest on the cement part and this would go into your grass part, and it would just roll along there and cut off the grass roots to give you a clean edge. Well, we have taken it another step. Here is a gas-powered edger that will do the same thing, only it uses a motor. Boys and their toys, I tell ya.
Well, let me tell you that if I had a lot of edging to do, which we do, I know which tool I prefer.
Yes, this has worked very well. We've used it grass, between grass and flower bed, and also grass and sidewalk. It works extremely well.
Well, the other thing too is they have these in electric version, but I don't, you know, when we're on location or someplace,
yes,
and you're helping out in somebody else's
work.
Garden.
Sure.
Now, the only drawback is you better know if you have low voltage wiring or something, you know, even a sprinkling system,
right,
and you better know the depth of that system or where it is
where it
to
is.
Make sure you don't slice into it, because
right,
once you start using this baby, it cuts.
Well, that goes with any time you're going into the soil. You need to know where are those wires and
pipes
and
well, cables.
Cable lines.
Yeah.
Cable
telephone.
Lines are definitely not very deep into the soil. They may be right under the soil, so be sure you check. Make sure you know where you're digging and what's underneath.
Well, we even knew where we were digging and still cut into a cable line.
This is the Blue Jays decided that they would add to our conversation.
Yeah.
If you're in this part of the country, you need one of these puppies. Now, they have hand ones, obviously.
And electric.
This is one of our tools that we use in summer. We use it several times a week. As the growing season slows down, we use it less, but maybe more extensively once the leaves get down and we chop those up.
Well, so in spring and fall, when the grass is really growing, like right now, we have to cut our grass at least twice a week, if not more.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because it's growing so quickly.
Right, and we leave it tall. We leave it like 3 inches tall in the growing season.
But in fall, we lower the blades because
yes,
we want to be able to get it down to maybe about an inch and a half or so,
right,
so that most of the growth again goes to the roots and not just to the grass.
That's right. Fall is still the best time to do fertilizing. So if that's something you do on your lawn, if you put fertilizer on, this is the time of year to do it most effectively. This is called a broadcast spreader.
Well, it's a hand spreader because you can put your hand in there.
Right, and you hold it up here and then you just crank it out and it spreads. Now, sometimes you can use different things in here. Couldn't you put grass seed in here?
Absolutely. So what you do is get your hand in there like a gun,
oh,
a paint
right,
gun.
Okay. Obviously, I don't do this very often. And then it opens up the little chute inside to determine how much comes out, how fast it comes out. And if you have something that's you need a bigger area to do, then you can use this little broadcaster that works the same way. You can set this dial to see how tall,
how big of an opening.
Big an opening you so want.
Press the little handle and there you go.
Okay. So we have also found it handy for when we need to put salt, rock salt, on the driveway or the walkways because of the ice. Works there too. It gets a little rusty after a while because the salt will eat away at the metal parts, but
well, that's why you buy plastic.
Very handy. One of the very basic tools that we have found and used millions of times, I swear it's millions.
Millions?
A good wheelbarrow. This is a two-wheel wheelbarrow, which makes it much more stable than the one. But
lift it with one hand once. So there you go.
Yeah, it's the leverage that you get using a wheelbarrow is amazing. I remember as children, my sister and I would give each other rides in the wheelbarrow just because it was so much fun. We could lift each other very easily and push because of the leverage. It carries so many different things. It gets all scarred up and cruddy looking, and it still works. Love it. And sometimes you have different needs that a wheelbarrow would work with, but something that would be even more efficient would be some, like a giant wagon. We have used this not only for moving fertilizer and bales of straw, or plants that we bought at the
mulch,
or that we've got at the nursery and garden center and we need to move over, but also we have used this as a planting bed, putting our actual potted plants in here and being able to move it from sunny to shady or inside because it was going to freeze. It's just very handy, and because it has a grate on the grated bottom, you can water the plants and it'll run right through. They're not going to be sitting in water. Never a good thing.
Well, it's a nice place to put plants for a temporary purpose.
Yes.
Until they're hardened enough to get out into full sun.
And last but not least is your broom. Oftentimes when you're doing gardening, you end up with messes that need to be swept away. And a good broom is always a handy thing to have on hand. Doesn't need to be a big one like this. In fact, I prefer my smaller one, but this is good for big chores. These are just a few of the many, many tools that are available for you to use in your yard, let alone all the huge machines that they use, like skidders and bulldozers.
Tractors.
And graders and tractors. Yes, just tractors or riding lawnmowers, all the different bigger mechanical tools that are available. But we enjoy what we have and we use it every day. We're using one or another of our tools. But here's a pop quiz for you. Of all the basic tools we showed, what's one that you probably have in your arsenal of tools that we didn't show? Did you guess it?
Aha. Well, how many of you got it right? We'd love to know.
So we hope you've enjoyed this little video showing what tools we use. By all means, you do not need to use all of these tools, but there are possibilities, and if you see them and they're a good price, be sure to get them.
And quality, because price alone, how many times have we bought a cheap something,
right,
and
it breaks.
Didn't even last a season?
We've had those.
So,
right. So it's better to have a few quality tools than many tools that'll break and just put you back, not only financially, but time-wise.
Yep.
So if you've enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up. We appreciate that. And we are so thankful that you are watching and commenting and asking questions. If you'd like to join our garden family, please subscribe. We'd love to have you. Have to go in now, put away all my tools before it rains again. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.